Good morning, everybody. It is supposed to be summer here with Wild Earth TV. You are watching Safari Live. It doesn't feel like summer. It's supposed to be also the weather report has told another foul and contemptible lie. They've said it's 15 degrees Celsius. I do not believe it to be 1 degree above 10 where I'm sitting now, and that is roughly just under 50 degrees Fahrenheit. We're sitting at the very south of the reserve. My name is James Hendry. You are on a live safari, and I will be your guide this morning. On camera, we have Tebs. Hello, Tebs. Tebs has a blanket around his legs. That is how cold it is today. Now, before we get going with the business of the day, it's important to note that on the other vehicle or on foot, depending on what we can get to work, is Scott Dyson. Now, this is an important day for Scott Dyson because it is his 30th birthday. He is no longer a young man. He is old like me. He was looking pretty decrepit this morning, but we're hoping that a little time on foot in the wilderness will rejuvenate him. So please wish him the happiest of birthdays today. Depending on what we see, we might have to have a bit of a birthday song a bit later. He will be filmed by the inimitable but diminutive Wim Dorenbrach, and on the final control. If you're ever wondering what I'm doing when I suddenly look like this, it means I'm being spoken to in the ear by the final control room, and today we have Jerry directing and assisted by Tara and Nikki. Right, then on to the business of the day, the live safari, on which you are most welcome, and we're greatly happy to have you along. Hashtag Safari Live if you want to ask any questions at all on the Twitter. Or questions at wildearth.tv if you want to email us. I've stopped here in the very south of the property at a place called Twin Dams. It's the lowest point on the reserve. That's probably why it's the coldest as well. Unseasonably cold weather we're having now. And I've stopped because I'm wanting to try and see if we can hear some lions. They were calling during the night, I think probably some of them to the south and some to the north. And unfortunately, I don't think any on Juma at the moment. Anyway, we're going to go, we'll do a sort of boundary drive this morning, and then we'll head off to Arethusa and we'll see what we can find on that end. Just to give you a quick idea while I'm listening here, we use a lot of confusing names, and if you're perhaps a new viewer or a first-time viewer, this is how it works. We sit in 8 million hectares. I'm only going to do it in metric today, this time around. I'll do it in Imperial some other time. We're sitting in 3.5 million hectares of wildlife land. That is the Greater Limpopo Transfrontier Park. That is three separate national parks, but that are joined. Kruger National Park in South Africa, the Limpopo National Park of Mozambique, and the Gonarezou National Park in Zimbabwe, and that's joined by something called the Sengwe Corridor. Anyway, that's, you just need to remember, we're in 3.5 million hectares of contiguous wildlife land. We are then on the western side of the Kruger National Park in a collection of private farms that have come to be known as the Sabi Sands. So we're on the very western fringes of that enormous wildlife agglomeration in the Sabi Sands. Within the Sabi Sands, we're in the northern portion on a property called Juma. That's where we sit now. And to the west of us, we use a small property called Arethusa. So it's 900 hectares here, 600 hectares there. We traverse a total of 1,500 hectares. On Juma, there are two lodges where people can come and stay. One is called Vuyatela and the other is called Galago. So those are the confusing names you may hear. And we sometimes use some of the other names of the lodges around here when we talk about where various animals are. So I hope that's given some relative clarity to the astonishing array of different names that we give to what must seem like exactly the same place from where you're sitting. I hear no lions. I hear only orioles cawing in the background, very beautiful liquid call. Babblers. While I'm listening to the birds, Rebecca in Santa Barbara, you say the wind seems to have subsided. It has subsided mercifully. So the cats are shy and dawn chorus is deafening. It is wonderful. So we're having a wonderful dawn chorus today. And maybe it is, like you say, time for a birding safari. There's some cisticulas calling. There are ringneck doves all over the place. Orioles, like I say, drongos, hornbills. emerald spotted wood doves, laughing doves, Franklins. That's marvellous. Babblers, crested barbets. Beautiful morning. Oh, there's a hyena carrying a monkey or something. Right, no, in fact, it's carrying the head of a the head of a impala. Here we go. I don't know where it's stolen from. Very interesting. Hold on, Tim's, don't fall out. This morning did not start well for that. There's a whole lot of impala running there. Went in here. There. Look at that. It's hugely fat. It's massively fat. It's just come from south of the reserve. Now try and follow it. And thank you for your updates. Apparently there were a great deal of hyena activity at the Juma Dam during the course of the night, eating catfish. Thank you, Kevin, for that. There we go. Look at that. Charging away with a piece of carcass. Where he's stolen it from, I can't imagine. Now, hyenas are not normally as confiding as the cats, so I'm going to keep my distance. Is he carrying? Hugely fat. Actually looks like a piece of waterbuck, maybe. Let's follow the hyena. Very, very fat belly. So I think definitely been eating for a long time. What on earth is she's carrying? You can hear, I don't know if you can hear, but as she runs, the rattling cisticulas start alarm calling. Now, a hyena has an astonishing ability and astonishing stamina. So it'll run like that with a huge thing in its jaws for ages. And I wonder if she isn't taking it back, perhaps, to the den. You can see, even when we stop, she keeps going at the same speed. Okay, let's see where she goes. Size of her belly. She has been eating all night. I mean, she's morbidly obese. I didn't expect to see that this morning. You just never know. You just never know what you're going to see. She's heading off now on a game path. I don't know if we'll be able to keep up with her. We'll try. She's just cutting the corner. Go straight back onto the road. I don't want to get too close to her because she is. I think she. We don't want to chase her. They don't generally. Like I say, like to walk at gentle speeds that the cats do when we're with them, which is odd because as cubs, they are extremely confiding. The vehicles, they chew bits and pieces off them, but as adults, not so much. I still can't work out exactly what species of animal she's carrying. there's supposed to be, Brent found a den, of the a new den for the hyenas, just to the north of Gallagher Camp. And I think that's where she's going. You can't get in there in a car, unfortunately, the other one. Goes with that. She's still quite a distance from there. But like I say, the most phenomenal stamina, even with a fat belly like that. Really is astonishing. I would say what she's carrying there is probably maybe 12 kilograms, so about almost 30 pounds. Just in her jaws, and she's running like she's not carrying anything at all. She goes, look at her belly wobbling from side to side. Thank you, Sandra, for your comment and your warning. You say that I need to be slapped for calling a female obese. It's not so much an insult as a statement of fact. That hyena is obese, enormously fat. And the carnivores, of course, will thin down very quickly. Their bellies get full. So while obese is probably a better description for something that is fat, is laid down a lot of fat, this hyena will be very lean, and it's actually just almost carrying the fuel for the next week in the belly. And I think, Penny, you're probably also correct. You say maybe she's pregnant. I think that's quite possible. That is an it's a nyala. Nyala, I think. We'll stop here, we'll get a better look now. Here we go. Yeah, it's Nyala horns, Nyala spinal column. I think she is pregnant, Penny. She's got very swollen teats. She's also had a hugely good meal, though, too. That's interesting. Okay, everybody, I don't think we're going to follow her all the way up. In my humble opinion, we should go back down to where she came from. That, to me, looks suspiciously like it was killed by wild dogs. And she's also going into some thick bush now. Let's go down there and see if we can't pick up where she stole that from. She's just going to keep going. I think probably the den's another sort of kilometer up the road. I think she's just going to keep moving up there. Yeah, so I think let's leave her to go into the thick bush there. We won't be able to follow her through the thick stuff. Let's go back down towards Twin Dams and see if we can't find who she stole that from. I also saw, as we saw her, I saw a whole lot of impala tearing off across the road, just to the north of that, so maybe there's some activity there. Let's go and look. Another update from the Juma Dam cam from the night. Thank you, Donna. You say the hyena were hooping all night long. Well, I think that was that thing looked to me like it was being fairly recently killed. You could see it was very darkly coloured, and that's because there was all sorts of muck on the edge of the spinal column. So whoever she stole that from, I'm sure was very cross. I don't think I say wild dogs because they would have struggled to get at the spinal column, then they would have eaten the rest of it and torn it apart. It's possible that there was that. It's also possible that if it's not as recently killed as I think it is, that maybe it was a leopard that had it caught up in a tree and that piece fell down. I certainly didn't smell anything coming off it, so I don't think it was very old. I go down towards the south and see if we can't find where that Nyala was stolen from. The birthday boy is up and running and would like to greet you this morning. I'll see you a little bit later.
Hello everyone and welcome on board. My name is Scott, for those of you who haven't met me. For those of you who have and have sent through birthday wishes, thank you so much for that. Really, really kind of you. And looking forward to having a great day on safari with all of you guys. And also VM on camera. We have headed into the northern parts of the property in the hope that some wild dog that were just a little bit north of our northern boundary may come running through Juma. And it's been many months now since I've actually seen wild dog. I guess a lot of you may have had more sightings with the other presenters than me over the recent few weeks as they've returned into this general area. So really, really looking forward to seeing them again. And who knows, maybe it will happen in the next few minutes. So far though, haven't seen too much sign of anything happening. Although there's a lot of elephant tracks here and they look like they're of a very, very big bull. Massive, massive feet. The tracks are probably about this round. And I'm told that James has already shared his thoughts with you on that carcass that the hyena are carrying around. You guys have got off to a great start with that sighting, so well done to James for getting you into that position. And wouldn't that be nice if the wild dog were in fact successful in bringing down an Nyala? I've never actually seen them bring down an Nyala in this area. It's always been impala or duiker, so not to read into that too much, but they, as far as I'm aware, in this area do specialize on the smaller prey. The packs aren't usually that large. So Nyala is slightly bigger than normal, which is interesting. And a good sign for that pack that they can successfully take down larger prey. Get to show you. Oh, look at how beautiful those clouds are. But it's not only the clouds we'd like to show you, there's a bird right at the top of this dead tree on the kind of central branch. It almost looks like an extension of the branch. There we go. Oh, good morning. Big stretch. Don't go anywhere just yet though. And look at how awesome that is with the cloud in the background. Oh, well, I'm glad you got to see it. That's the Cape Turtle Dove. They're making a huge commotion at this time of the year trying to seduce other turtle doves. Krukruru! Krukruru! Is the call that you may have heard just before I stopped the vehicle. Well, we are going to send you back to James and that interesting sighting with the hyena. I hope you enjoy it, and it's just at the perfect time because we've just got a roadblock that we need to deal with. We'll see you later.
So we've come back to exactly the same spot we first saw you, and here is a much younger hyena and probably a male, but very fat. equally fat. Look at that. Isn't that wonderful? I think they have done a great deal of thieving to the south of us today. So in much less of a hurry, obviously, a young male, we're not going to follow him for a great distance, he's just come out of the south of the property. We start to run when you start to follow them. We'll just pull up onto the wall here and watch. Now, a very interesting inquiry from Diane in Michigan asking, could she have taken the, that's not this one, the other hyena, could she have taken that Nyala head and horns to the den to feed a cub? Yes, exactly. I think that's probably precisely what she was doing. But she'd eaten her full, she's looking very full, might be pregnant, but you see, to carry it back to the den, I suspect that she was actually just full and lactating, and that's why she looked so fat. We'll just have a quick look at this young chap, and then we'll go back around there and do some snooping. I think that they've stolen something way quite deep into the property to the south of us. As we look at this much smaller, you can see that he, well, maybe you can't, you probably can't because you can't see them together. But this is, he is much smaller than the original one that we saw. Definitely a male. And Diane, as you say, that spinal column will be wonderful nutrition for the hyenas. Not quite as good as bone marrow, which would come from the big leg bones, the femur. Look at that. They really are such splendid animals. I always think when people say they're closely related to dogs, if you look at the tail is that kind of flappy, whisky, very, it's the most uncat-like or dog-like tail you can imagine. There we go. We're going to let him go then. We'll just go and fossick around a little bit in the south and see if we can't see anything around Twin Downs. So, looks in very good condition and probably going to go back to the den, or maybe just closer to the center of their territory. A male like that will be really a kind of second-class citizen in hyena society, and they will probably go up towards more the center of the territory. They don't want to be hanging around on the outside of the territory, and in the center of the territory is the den. And they might not go straight right up to the den, but they'll lie around it. They'll be in and around the area where the den is and rest up for the day and enjoy digesting what was clearly a very good meal early this morning. Possibly, we're quite a long way from the Juma Dam camp, so for them to have been heard whooping from here, I think would be unlikely. So it was probably other members of the clan whooping territorially closer to where the dam is. And I'm 100% sure now that the carcass head, that head was that of a Nyala and not a kudu. Julia, you've asked, are we sure that it was a Nyala, not a kudu? I am sure, and I can tell you why. Once we saw the horns properly, with a kudu, they make a corkscrew spiral. With a Nyala, it's more of a twist. And those were definitely twisted male Nyala horns. Very similar to bushbuck horns, but much bigger. But, if you saw them sitting next to kudu horns, you wouldn't mistake them. Makwalan. Ebo, Tim is it who Makwalan? Tina Nyala, Titsutsumale, I'm sure Lekaya. Yeah. Good morning. Makon. Okay. All right. Bye-bye. So that, everybody, of course, is I don't know if we show, we're not allowed to show you the guests, you see, but that particular guest we could show you because it was Tara who drove you yesterday. That's Aubrey, the guide, and he's going to go and look around Torchwood. Apparently there are reports of wild dogs there, so that's very good news. I think we're going to move in that direction as well and see if they don't pop across here onto Juma, which would be marvellous. Torchwood is the property to the east of us. We, of course, can't go there, but the animals are free to come and go as they please. And I'm very pleased that they're pleased to come into Juma this morning. These hyena, quite a busy road today, indicating to the left, but another vehicle coming along at high speed. Almost bounced some guest out. Goodness gracious. Being on the interstate.
What? Tim, do you see any other cars?
No. Right, so we will go at a much more gentle and sedate pace. I suspect Roy there was going off towards Cheetah Plains. That's the reserve off to the south. So, Mike and Lisa, when I said that female hyena was heading towards the den, yeah, I mean towards the den where you, about which you're asking. You're asking, do we know where the den is, where that little cub was? We do know where it is, but we can't drive in there. You can't get a vehicle into where it is. They've picked a very clever spot where it is, there's a lot of very thick bush. You can get in there on foot, but we don't disturb it on foot. We found it on foot, but we can't get in there. We don't go in on foot to view it, because you'll disturb the den and they'll move it again. So I'm pretty sure that female is from exactly the same clan that we normally watch, and she'll be heading off towards where the baby is now sitting. And that baby is now probably 5 months old, 5 or 6 months old. So we'll be almost unrecognizable from the last time we saw it. Completely spotted now. And we watched the incredible level of sort of stamina she had. She had the 12 kilos in her mouth, running along, just that very economical kind of canter, loping canter that they run at. And Blair, you want to know how far she ran? She ran probably, we followed her for about a kilometer, what is a kilometer in miles? It's just under half a mile. Just over half a mile, sorry. And she would have, I think she would have cut back onto the road, because this Twin Dams road goes dead straight up into, past the Juma Dam, into that big rock where the den is. And that would have been, just listening to the radio. It was just the game drive radio, so I have two radios going in my head. Nothing important. And she came from out the south there. I think she probably could have run about 3 or 4 kilometers, holding a piece of meat in her mouth. Very economical loping canter that they have. Now, I did hear some news yesterday about the wild dogs, that Investec pack that we've been watching. 3 adults and 10 babies, and at least 11 babies. And what's interesting is that we get lots of questions about the white tail that the wild dogs have. And every so often, you have a wild dog born with a black tail that doesn't have that white tip to it. And the Investec pack, one of those pups, had a black tail. And unfortunately, they seem to have, they went into Mala Mala, and there was a huge ruckus. We don't know what happened, but they came out of Mala Mala again with only 10 pups. There were 11, there now seem to be only 10, and it was the one with the black tail that unfortunately seems to have been killed by something in Mala Mala. They're at a very high risk stage, of course, those wild dogs that we've been watching, because they're moving with the pack now, three and a half months old. They're not nearly big enough and strong enough to really defend themselves, and they're only three adults to look after them. Hoped to find some lions today. We certainly heard them calling in the night. We didn't think it was on Juma, and certainly there were no reports from those of you who monitor the Juma Dam cam about lions calling anywhere close by. And Gail and Eddie, Abby, you would like an update on the lions and where they are. I don't really know, to be honest. I think the Solalas were on Arethusa yesterday. There seems to have been some kind of a ruckus and an injury to one of the males. One of the other males seems to have gone. So the Birmingham boys came into contact with the Solalas, and they chased them around. Those three young males will be in some kind of trouble, of course, because... Sorry, I'm just watching the road here. Because the Birminghams won't tolerate them hanging around. And we think one is missing, and another one is definitely injured. So there is a bit of trouble with the Solala. And so Scott is going to head across to Arethusa now, I've just heard on the radio, and he'll try and get an update from them on those Solala pride. I don't know where the Nkuhumas are. I think it's still amazing that Junior is still around with the pride, and he does seem to be still with the pride. I think they're in the north. I'm pretty sure they're avoiding the Birmingham boys, and the Birmingham boys are, they're just not pushing north anymore. They did one foray through here, their first one in about a month, and then they've headed back south again, back onto Arethusa, caused trouble there, and I think they're kind of pushing around. They're a little bit further north than they've been for the last few weeks, but they haven't been into around here or into the Manulet, into Bibbleshoek, which is the property north of us. So that's as much as I can tell you at the moment, I'm afraid. Taxon and Aubrey will probably go into Bibbleshoek this morning and see if there aren't any lion tracks around there. We, of course, will drive around here and see if there aren't any lion tracks around Juma. And I read some interesting stuff, just to reconfirm some pretty... It's always a good idea to go back to the books every so often and just check the basic facts. And what I was reading a little article on lions, and there was nothing particularly astonishing about it or in-depth, but it did reiterate the fact that young males like Junior very often do manage to form coalitions with unrelated males. Now, we're so used to seeing prides of lions, like that Solala pride with three young males, which would automatically go off together and create and form a coalition. I mean, they're born into a coalition almost. But a young male like Junior, and for those of you who don't know who Junior is a three and a half, well, he's probably, yeah, he's three and a half rising for your old male lion that is still with his natal pride, and that's quite unusual. He's quite old to still be with the pride, and we were all very worried about what's going to happen to him, because he's carrying some pretty impressive likelihood is, like I say, that he will leave the pride eventually and form a coalition with an unrelated male or two, which would be great. That will then provide him with the strength, hopefully, to take a territory of his own. Right, let's go across to Scott. He's made a good decision. He's headed across to Arethusa, and he has a birthday elephant. See you just now.
Welcome back, everyone. And we've stumbled upon a large herd of elephants. These are two young bulls that have been playing a little bit of argy-bargy with one another. And the youngster on the right was thinking about coming and displaying his size and strength to us, but then at the last moment backed off, and that was as you came to us. Let's see what this one does now, though. Thanks, boy. Thanks for not causing any trouble with us. And there's seems to be quite a few more passing off to the right of the vehicle. I can also hear lots of branches breaking off in the distance. Oh, we need to move forward quickly. There's a tree that you can see being shaken from side to side there, and it's gonna get pushed over, it looks like. Oh, please continue. So I can take a closer look, and it may be trying to get seed pods off the tree. They will shake trees at this time of the year in order to try and speed up the fruits or seed pods to drop down rather than waiting for them to naturally fall. Or this large cow may actually have been hoping to push over that whole tree. It's a knobthorn acacia, I think. Yeah, it's a knobthorn acacia. She's a beautiful cow, great tusks. I think you may have just managed to get a glimpse of the tops of that tree shaking wildly. Sadly though, it was as we were rushing to try and get into position. There's a laughing dove calling very close to us that you can hear. And if that little laughing dove does start calling again, I may ask Viam to swivel the camera around to it so you get to see it calling. We actually don't really see laughing doves too much, but I've noticed they've come back into the area more this summer. They're not migratory birds. Oh, sorry, Viam, it's just flown off, but it was sitting right there. The birds so often fool around with us. But like I said, there's quite a few more of them around than normal at the moment, so we'll definitely be able to get you a few more visuals later on. Now, let's see, this big cow has moved back a little bit closer towards the trunk of this tree, and let's see if she doesn't have another crack at pushing it down, or at least shaking it. It's one of my favorite things to watch, elephants shaking trees to dislodge the fruits. Marulas are one to look forward to because they're quite a heavy fruit, and when about 40 or 50 of them hit the ground simultaneously, it makes a wonderful noise, and then the elephant excitedly moves around and starts gobbling them up, sometimes two or three at a time. We can maybe try and get into a slightly different angle, and I want to try and get onto the trajectory where this cow and two young calves will probably be walking following the rest of the herd when she moves off from that tree, and she probably won't be feeding on that tree for too much longer because it's going to start trying to defend itself by sending out very bitter tannins. And acacia trees are rumored to have the ability to even be able to communicate with other acacia trees in the area and warn them that elephants are moving through the area, they're under attack, so you can even start pushing out those bitter tannins before a tree's been started or has started to be fed on. Oh, we've got some action on the right here. Viam's already on it. It's one of the same young bulls that we saw earlier on. Oh, you are big and scary. You shake that bush. We are parked on a steaming pile of elephant dung, which actually smells quite nice. Quite earthy. Okay. Well, I'm torn as to what to do. I'm thinking, instead of going back to that car, I'm guessing it's going to come in this direction fairly shortly. We should get in front of the rest of the herd and let them make their way past us. Hello. Come on. Come. Come closer. Come on. It's my birthday. If you pick up a little flower and give it to me, it would be incredible, but this is still good. Wasn't that awesome? Now we can continue with, no, I don't think we can continue. It's all happening here, I don't know where to go. But it's going to be back to that cow that we were watching earlier. Maybe we can even just let's get there quickly. Sorry, Vian, sending you all over the show there. But there's something that we don't see very often, and that the elephant is reaching high up into the tree, trying to get to these seed pods or branches that she was trying to shake down earlier. So let's see if she's still doing it, which I hope she is. We'll just stop here. I can see she's holding her tail very awkwardly to the side, and that's a good indicator that an elephant's not entirely happy with something. I'm not sure whether it was with us or with its little calf. This one's giving us a good smell. Wonderful sighting this is. What a great way to be spending my birthday. You are correct indeed, Jeannie in Washington, so thanks for sending that through. And it's such a beautiful day. The clouds are also probably worth having a quick look at. I'm a massive fan of clouds and the wonderful patterns and shapes they form. And look at that for a beautiful skyline. It's a wonderful day. It's not only beautiful to look at, but it's keeping us nice and cool. We're incredibly lucky at the moment and thoroughly enjoying the cool weather. So great to be on safari with all of you guys, and thanks for joining in the adventure. I'm gonna probably just creep forward a bit to give VM a better view. And I'm told that Gwendolyn and Sheila, a few other safari goers, are also celebrating their birthdays today. And isn't that wonderful? Hope you guys are having a wonderful day or night wherever you are, and that you've been spoiled rotten. And I think this youngster might start spoiling us. This could be interesting. Look at it go. Look at its tail. Oh, yes, this is awesome. It's not making the funniest sound, but it was hilarious to watch, and VM did a great job following it through that thick bush. That was incredible. Now I'm I'm wondering what to do here. I just want to creep forward a little bit, very slowly, and I'll get you hopefully some more slightly better views of this massive elephant cow. I can't believe that one youngster ran off so quickly and so far away, because I'm guessing that this is its mother. So I'm not sure if there's some kind of kiddies playgroup happening with the rest of the herd, that it was started feeling left out, it was not joining in the fun with. But that was really interesting. You'll notice a slight stain running down the side of her head, just behind her eye. And there is a gland there, temporal gland, which is often a great indicator of elephants being in a kind of excited mood. It could be excited for the good reasons or excited for possibly bad reasons, but hers doesn't look very fresh. It's just an old stain, so you may have noticed that and be wondering what that's all about. And I think she's decided to go and keep an eye on her little youngster that went charging off earlier. It was so cool. Also gives you a good idea how quickly elephants can move. Obviously that was just a youngster, but I can assure you when there's a big one coming charging in at full speed, it can be a very daunting thing to experience. About being on safari with all of you guys is that we get a constant flow of wonderful questions, and a lot of them we may have answered in the past. That's one of the things that you become accustomed to as a guide. Understandably, there's a lot of frequently asked questions, but the one we're about to hear from Mike in Florida is one that I haven't actually been asked before, so that's always quite refreshing. And Mike is interested to know, if an elephant was very close, within about 10 meters, and it let out a loud trumpet, how loud would it be in decibels? Well, I do not have the faintest idea. VM, do you know how to, I mean, would you know how to measure in decibels or be able to give a figure or a guess off the top of your head?
No, but you can use your iPhone to do that.
Oh, you see, VM is a man that knows how to solve problems, and he's just solved that one, so we're going to have to try and work that one out for you, Mike. But it can be extremely loud, especially if it's the high-pitched, it's kind of more of a scream. I guess you get different tones. Even though they're all considered to be trumpeting, some are almost like a high-pitched scream, and others are more of a roar. If it is a high-pitched scream, though, it's incredibly loud. But like VM says, we're going to have to get out some form of technology to help aid in helping us work out how many decibels exactly that is. Now, I haven't left the elephants. I'm just trying to do a big loop around them. And that way allow them to continue slowly moving towards us. They seem to be a little bit worked up, this herd. Not anything serious, but I'd rather just make sure we give them lots of space and let them decide how close they want to come to us. Good question though, Mike. And even that little youngster you would have heard making a bit of a racket as it was running off there was quite loud. I remember kind of midway through the year, a lot of you will be aware of the herd of elephants. It's a mother with two calves. There's almost all the time there's just three of them. And when the one calf was getting weaned, the younger calf was getting weaned, it was about midway through the year.
It was trumpeting constantly, day and night. We could just hear this poor elephant calf that was desperate for some more milk, but its mother was refusing, and it was letting out these loud, sulking trumpets that we could hear from very far. Oh, there was another trumpet I just heard now that you may just have picked up. I've got slightly into the wrong area. I can see the elephants, but they seem to be veering off more to the west. And while we try and get into a good spot for these elephants, we're gonna send you back to James, who's with another large gray animal.
I hope you've been enjoying those birthday elephants with Scott. We've come to Buffleshoek Dam. There are reports of the wild dog tracks to the east of us in Torchwood, so we're just going to stand by here for a little while. And there's some wonderful activity going on here. You can see a huge, well, not huge pod, but for Buffleshoek Dam, a huge pod of hippos. And they are topped, if you like, with a grey heron that is just kind of taking liberties, sitting on top of it. And all around the dam, we've got a variety of water birds that are enjoying the sort of rapidly shrinking water, if you like, and the food that it's providing. You've got the saddle-billed storks, a couple, an endangered species with the yellow, no, those are the woolly necks, those are the woolly necks. Saddle-billed are those two ones with the yellow on the beaks and the red beaks. There we go, endangered species they are, and a couple of them. So they will hopefully be breeding and becoming slightly less endangered as the summer goes on. And then of course you've got the woolly-necked storks, which are migratory birds that have just arrived here. They're all over the place at this dam now. And I think the most special bird here, my favorite one. If you just pan slowly to the right along the shore's edge there, what you'll get is that white bird, which is a spoonbill. Keep going. It is there. That's in the middle. The spoonbill, African spoonbill, which has a beak that is unsurprisingly shaped like a spoon. And what they do is, you see what they do, they move their beaks from side to side, picking up little things that they can find in the mud on the bottom. Beautiful, beautiful birds here. There's a hummercock lurking around somewhere, frog eater. And the dawn chorus is dimmed slightly to we're into sort of the second movement, if you like. If you think of it as a symphony, we have the explosion of the first movement, and we're into the slower, quieter, more contemplative second movement now. I can hear a squirrel alarm calling way off to the north. We'll drive around that way, but I have found in recent experience has shown that squirrels seem to alarm call at absolutely everything. And I'm not absolutely sure that they are necessarily alarm calling all the time. Just a quick message for the final control. I was unplugged by mistake, so if they're trying to talk to me, they'll have to repeat themselves. Sorry about that, Jerry. And you can hear that some sunbirds in that green tree there, Tibbs. See the tree I mean? Right at the top there. There. Well, that's not the sunbird, but they're in that tree where the sunbirds and they've flown off. That is a... looks like a red-billed buffalo. It doesn't seem to have a red bill if you require my powerful binoculars. No, it is a red-billed buffalo weaver. And the bird you can hear calling, going wah, 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 is an Egyptian goose. Hyena coming down to drink. Today is the day of the hyena. Now, Barbara, you're concerned about the water, and every time we come here, there's some very good questions about water balance and what we do. That squirrel wasn't lying. It was alarm calling, obviously, at that hyena. Barbara, if this water dries up, there's still, if this is the Sabi sands, there's plenty of water around. There's water in the Sand River. There's water on Biffle's Hook that is pumped. There's water at the Juma Dam that is pumped. So I don't think you need to worry too much about that. What is this hyena doing and where is he going? Again, that beautiful loping canter gait that they have. So let's see if he comes around here. I think he's going to go around the back of us. I don't want to move just yet. You can see the sun coming through now. There he goes. I'm just going to watch where he goes before we start swinging the vehicle around at a fast speed. Well, as fast as Jigger is able to go. Coming straight past us here, through the bush there. Now, Tibbs, you might get a look there. You just see maybe the shadow going through the bush there. I think that might be worth following. Let's go and try and cut him off on the road. We're not cutting him off. Let's see if we can't catch him. And I say him because it's another small one, but clearly hasn't been devouring things like the others were. Quite lean. Maybe going back to the den to share of that Nyala carcass. Beautiful scene at Biffle's Hook. Some big grey clouds coming in from the northeast. That's quite unusual. So that hyena was coming along here on this game path here. I'm sure she's come down the road already. Now, we've spoken about the hyena den and its inaccessibility to vehicles. And Sean, you want to know if we could bushwalk in there. Technically, yes, we could, Sean. We could walk in there, but you've got to be very careful about sensitivity at den sites. If we disturb it too much, what they'll do is just up and move again. And on foot, we disturb amazingly more so than we do. You got him. Well spotted, Debs. Try and get in here. Where are you going? He looks to me like he smells something. He's now turned around. He's heading into the block here. I'm going to just drive straight up the same road. So, Sean, he went off through there. Sean, amazingly, on foot, we disturb them more than we do in the vehicle. And that's because they're just so much more threatened by us on foot. So, we'll probably steer clear of going in there on foot for the bushwalk. If there is a really good view, and there isn't in there, if there was a really good kind of view that you could get at a distance without disturbing them, absolutely would go in. Now, what is this hyena smelling? You can hear the birds' alarm calling in there now. Maybe he's just heading through. It's very inaccessible through there. But maybe, just maybe, he smelt the carcass of something hanging from a tree and is going to investigate. This was the last place that we saw Mvula. Mvula is a male leopard, in case you're wondering. Right, let's go quickly across to Scott. I'm going to try and get around and see if we can't find where that hyena went. He has a special bird to show you.
Look at how beautiful this swallow is, basking in the morning sunshine. They are such awesome birds, but because they fly so quickly, most of the time we don't get to see them, and they also do spend a large portion of their day soaring around catching tiny insects. Oh, it looks like it's getting its flight gear ready for an another one of these flights. They are incredibly talented flyers, and it would be wonderful to just for a few moments be able to experience what it's like to be in that little body of theirs. They can soar very close to water or any structures really at incredibly high speeds and dart off at the final moment. Now, this is a red-breasted swallow, if I'm not mistaken, and oh, there it goes. It was a red-breasted swallow. Incredibly fast flying birds, and I wonder if James might actually be able to see some at Buffalsert Dam, where you guys are spending some time now. I noticed quite a few of them yesterday collecting mud there at the water's edge, and they build wonderful, wonderful nests out of mud that they carry from obviously water holes or any little puddles back to a set area, usually kind of a cave or an overhang, and then they'll build their nests up against the roof of that wall and leave a tiny little entrance hole, almost like an upside down igloo, you could say, I guess. So keep an eye out if you do go back to James, and he is still at Buffalsert Dam. So I'm thinking of popping across to Arethusa. We're going to be there shortly. So we'll hopefully get some good updates from them on the radio. Although there's no guarantees about that. There's only one way to find out, and that's to go across there. So looking forward to the potential excitement of some good news. If not, Arethusa is a wonderful, wonderful property with lots to do and see, even if there aren't any confirmed sightings already. Just mentioning how wonderful it would be to be able to climb into the body of one of those swallows to experience what it's like to be able to fly at high speeds and be highly maneuverable. And Siberia Zumi is obviously wondering what it's like to experience a kind of different kind of flight, and that is to be one of the eagles that soars high up in the sky, or the vultures. And she would like to know which one will soar higher more typically, and vultures by far, Siberia Zumi. They are well developed for traveling at high altitudes, being able to search for their prey, whereas bateleurs are better adapted to be lower down, closer to the ground, almost just over the treetops, searching for their prey or carrion to feed on. So bateleurs are often the first of the carrion eating raptors to get to kills, because they are the ones that fly the lowest. And to give you an idea of how vultures, how high they can actually fly, one has been sadly churned up in the turbine of an aeroplane, but it was at 27,000 feet, where there shouldn't have been enough oxygen for that vulture to even be conscious. But it was flying, and I guess an unlucky pilot and an unlucky vulture had a collision all the way up there. So really interesting that they can move at such high altitudes. Whereas I know most other birds of prey like bateleur have never been clocked quite that high. So we are going to be crossing over shortly. This is the boundary between Juma and Arethusa. And this is a road called Triple M. And we'll be traveling on it for a short period of time before turning off onto Red Dam Road. And we'll probably actually head straight towards Red Dam. The there's not too much water around on Arethusa either in this drought that we're experiencing. So if you are joining for the first time, don't be fooled by the flush of green. It would typically be a lot more dense, this foliage, already by this time of the year, and there would also be a lot more water around. We haven't had as much rain as we should have had by now, and that's on top of an extremely dry, rainy season last year. So water sources are good places to go and search for animals, as there's not much of it around. So that is what we shall be doing. We should be there in about 3 or 4 minutes, depending of course on what we bump into along the way. Some elephant dung that I spotted there. When they're nice and fresh like this, they look like giant bran muffins. And if you're gonna be able to get to that one, Vim, you should be. And if you look at that and you didn't know any better, you'd think it could be a chocolate cake. And it's actually not uncommon out in the bush to receive a chocolate cake, which is in fact just a big ball of elephant dung. That's a good example of that. So don't be fooled if on safari out here. Always think twice before somebody offers you a slice of cake. So it did look quite fresh, that elephant dung, but not incredibly so. Like, I'm not expecting to find the elephants around the next corner. There wasn't quite enough moisture on it for it to be very, very fresh. But maybe they're up a little bit ahead of us, maybe at the waterhole where we're about to go. Aramark babblers agree. They're not going to be easy for Vim to see or show you, but he's gone for it. There's somewhere just behind there. Oh, well done, Vim. He's spot on. Not the best view. Yay! I love it when you get to see the bird that's making the noise. Ah, that's perfect now. Aramark babbler. They've got a lot of kind of arrow-like stripes on their chest, or markings rather. A bright orange eye. And this characteristic racket that you can hear them singing out behind us. Can we call easily confused with the green wood hoopoe, also known as the red-billed wood hoopoe? Two quite similar calls, but this is more of a babble. The wood hoopoe is more, excuse me, of a cackle. But it is one that takes a bit of getting used to. They are quite easily confused. Well, I know you have been also having a great morning in terms of bird watching with James. It's really interesting, and I love the way kind of some days you get lucky with birds and you find what is called bird parties, and you'll have in one tree 5 or 6 different species, and Buffalo's Dam is a great place for that. I'm guessing a lot of the great birds you did see while you were there, I'm willing to take a gamble on this, were in the torchwood tree. It's usually alive with activity. And I remember having some great sightings last summer with you guys over there. Summer is definitely the best season for birding. They all have their brightest, shiniest plumage out, are singing as loudly as they ever will, and are twice as numerous as they are in the winter months, where half of them disappear into other parts of Africa and even further from there. Now this is going to be interesting because there were a pair of African scops owl in the tree that VM's just showed you. And let's go and take a closer look and see if there is any further sign of them. It would be incredible if they're sitting in the same tree again. They are animals of habit to a degree. And if they're not in this tree directly in front of us, well then maybe they'll be in another one nearby, but this is the one they were in. No worries. Liam, have you got it there? About kind of 11 o'clock between this dead tree and the knobthorn to the left of it. So if you just go to the left more, quite a lot more left of where you are, and then zoom in. There it is sitting at the, keep zooming, maybe full zoom, lower down. Have I got it there or am I dreaming? It is sitting there. I can still see it. It's just a little bit lower down, VM. Go straight down. There it is. It's behind a few bushes, but it is there. Little birds just landed right next to it. You can see a little bit of movement there. That's where the owl is. Just to the right of those little babblers, and they're babbling at it. I'm going to try and get us into a spot where we can see it. So they obviously do live here, these scops owls. Maybe they've got a nest nearby. Just going to try. Can you see it there, Bill?
No, I can see it.
Sorry, a bit of tricky angles here that we're working with, but there you can see it. Well done, VM. Not the best view. That is an African scops owl, and they're obviously living and quite possibly nesting in a cavity in one of the trees in this area. Sadly, we're not going to be able to get closer to it, but good to know that they live here. What a pleasant surprise. And well done, VM. It took us a little bit of toing and froing before we got to it. You may be wondering what those babblers are doing going up to the owl, which is a predatory bird and could well catch a babbler. And they are also VM. So we're going to forget about the owl temporarily and enjoy viewing this hyena. I know you guys have already been spending a lot of time with hyena with James, but we haven't. And we don't spend as much time as them away from the den sites as we would like. It's always a pleasant surprise. This looks like a youngster, still very clearly spotted. Most spots will tend to fade as they get a little bit older. And not the biggest hyena, so I'm guessing possibly a male. But that's all guesswork. They're incredibly difficult to distinguish between males and females. It's sniffing the ground closely. I would, just like I was saying, I'd love to be a bird for a couple of minutes to experience the art of flight. But to be able to experience and understand just how powerful the hyena's sense of smell is would also be something that would be quite wonderful to understand and experience. As I was saying though, the babblers are mobbing that owl because they want to let all the other birds in the area know that there is a potential threat nearby. So, not uncommon for smaller birds to come in very boldly and kind of ridicule and shout at any predators that they see. I think we might be in luck with the birding. There's some more action here.
the little water hole. And I've just actually seen a red-breasted swallow flying up above us, and it may well come down to collect some mud. Also a woolly-necked stork standing up above the waterhole there, and a few laughing doves have just flown off. What I'm thinking of doing is enjoying a little view of this woolly-necked stork and then creeping down into a slightly lower angle in case the red-breasted swallows do come back. I'm almost certain they are here to collect some mud to build their nests. And I'd like to show you them doing that. So let's get into a good spot for that to happen. Could be a long wait, but willing to take that risk. Anything else could come and drink. Other birds, other animals. So let's just get comfortable here somewhere. And see who is going to be our first visitor. So, like I was saying earlier, not much water around at the moment, and this is not going to last much longer. If we don't get rain within the next week, I'd say this will be dry. We stop here, we can do a lot of listening. You can hear Cape turtle doves calling in the distance, some more babblers now ringing out behind us. And Andres asked a question on the topic of birds and their calls and would like to know, how did the Piet Mevrouw bird get its name? Well, I'm not entirely sure who decided on that name. It's English name, or its official name, is the red-chested cuckoo. So this is just a kind of Afrikaans or Dutch name that's used for it, and its call rings out Piet Mevrouw, which Piet is a name and Mevrouw is my wife. So that's what the direct translation is. I'm not sure who decided the call rang out those exact words. I guess it does vary.
It means tweet my wife. Like his wife must tweet for him.
Oh! Thanks, VM. You see, VM's Afrikaans. Here's two laughing doves. We saw them earlier, and that's a little canary at the back. Little canaries. So the birds have already started coming down. There'll be a lot more of them to see, I'm sure. Three canaries now. One laughing dove's gone.
And I noticed this waterhole was a hive of activity the other day. We were enjoying a lion sighting here. And there was just a constant stream. Oh, the red-breasted swallow's back. Let's see if it comes down and lands. It just swooped overhead, as they do so quickly. And its partner's also back. So they're both flying around above us here. It's going to be impossible for VM to try and show you without you guys getting seasick. And I'm sure they're just doing one or two flights just to make sure that we aren't going to pose a threat to them. before they come down and get their nest building material. Just got a comment through from Donna mentioning that her swallows aren't as red back home. Not all of ours are, so this is kind of one of the more impressive swallows that we see in this area. I sadly forgot my book at home, otherwise I'd give you an idea of all the other different ones we have. We were planning on doing a bushwalk this morning and had the backpack and all the gear that VM had loaded up onto the car. We've powered it up to do some tests to see if it would work, and nothing. So in the haste to try and get into the vehicle, oh, Malakart Kingfisher, yes, can you believe it? VM, it just flew and popped into the water and it's landed in a bush. I'm guessing it may very well fly back into the water to have a bath. So I don't think it was hunting. It may have been, but if you just go into that green bush that's hanging over to the right, the next one to the right, it's just, there it is. Perfect, it's out in the open now. Look at this. It's a beautiful little bird. And one of the tiniest of the kingfishers. There it goes, poops, into the water for another bath. And it may well come back and take another bath. So let's see if VM can catch the next one. The vehicle's just driven past me, motioning with his hands, what have I seen? So I flapped my wings back at him. Isn't this an awesome bird? Look at those colors. And one that we seldom get to show you. There is also one that's resident at Buffalsook Dam, but I've noticed they only hang around in the summer months. Last summer they were also there, but in winter they tend to disappear. I'm not sure where they go. They do rely on water for catching their prey, and not all the kingfishers do, which is the interesting thing about them. Well, I can't see where it's sitting. I can see where okay, it keeps hopping around every time I go from the monitor to where it is actually sitting with my binoculars. Oh, well done, VM. You got him crashing into the water. Well played.
I've lost him now. No idea where he landed.
Oh, he's back. Yeah, well done. You also get a very similar looking tiny kingfisher called the pygmy kingfisher, which is migratory. Actually just wondering if that one may not actually be a pygmy kingfisher, but I didn't get a close enough look on it with my binoculars. Whoa, very pleasant surprise that was. And I guess that's one of the beauties of being able to sit and wait at a waterhole. You never know who's going to arrive. It could be a tiny little kingfisher, or who knows, a leopard could come around the corner next. Presence here may be preventing those red-breasted swallows from wanting to come down and collect their mud, because they did fly over earlier, and as we arrived they were also here, and I saw some collecting mud yesterday, so it's that time of the year for them, and I certainly don't want to delay somebody's home being built. So we will press on and see what else is happening. Doesn't seem to be too much chatter on the Arethusa radio waves, which is generally a signal that not much is going on. For now. Well, that could change at any moment though. up. Got a wonderful update through from Siberia Zumi. Thank you for this update. He's heard some bee eaters. I'm guessing they're probably European bee eaters. As their name suggests, they have come all the way from Europe. And they've only arrived very recently. So I haven't managed to show you any this summer. And we're not too far from the Arethusa Waterhole. So we're going to head straight there and see if we can get you a glimpse of them. If you can hear them, the reason why you can't see them, Siberia Zumi, is they are most vocal when they are flying. And they tend to fly quite high up in the sky, the European bee eaters, in quite large flocks. So I'm guessing the cam doesn't allow you to point up there. And that's why you can't find them anywhere, but we will be able to do that, so sit tight and we should be there in about 8 or 9 minutes. Seen her for quite some time, it was the day before I went on leave, so that works that out. Just over coming on 3 weeks ago, but that was a brief sighting of her whilst on foot. I didn't want to disturb her, she was busy executing an impala she had just caught, so I thought it would be best to skedaddle. As exciting as that was, it was a very brief sighting that Peter got to come in and enjoy in the vehicle. And I watched the highlights from that sighting, or actually the whole sighting just about. And wasn't it incredible what unfolded thereafter? She was barely finished suffocating that unfortunate impala when two hyena came running in and chased her off it, for those of you who weren't watching. That's what went down. It was a high action sighting. Asking when we could expect to see the next TV shows on Big Cat Week, when our team is going to expand again with Peter Hayden coming back, people coming from Joburg all over. So exciting times. And Anne-Marie, the Big Cat Week starts on the 26th of November until the 4th of December, where we'll be doing large amounts of live broadcasts, not only. So exciting times for us. It's a very different product that we've put out during those periods, with a lot more inputs and feeds, two vehicles, a bushwalk, a drone, plus Hayden in the safari tents. And with all those different inputs, it naturally changes the dynamic of the show quite a lot, and people enjoy it and find it quite exciting. So happy that it's happening soon, and hopefully we'll get more and more of these high intensity shows, because even for you guys, I'm sure you enjoy the change of pace and scenery. If you don't, well, sorry. At least you get a combination of the two, though, being able to watch on the internet and TV. Oh, I wonder how fresh these are. But there are some lion tracks here, I'll show you quickly. It's not going to be easy in this flat overcast light, but worth a try. Where's the best one, do you think, Vim? None of them are clear. This one, yeah, in flat light like this, it's very difficult to see tracks, but there are some pug marks and toe marks. There's the back pad of one there. There's one on the bottom corner here. You can also kind of see a few toes, so not easy, but a lion walked down here. Looks like a lioness, possibly one of those young males there from the Salada Pride. But we're going to send you back to James and try and decipher exactly how fresh these tracks are and who they belong to. See you later.
Right, we've come to an area around Vuyatela and Gallagher camps, which are the two camps at Juma. We left Vuvuzelk Dam. We didn't re-find that hyena who was scarpering off into the bushes. And we've had some squirrels alarm calling. And while it is not particularly bushy, one of the ecologists does have a dog at his home. And the dog is fitted with a... Well, I mean, the dog is basically alarm calling. It's barking at something. And the only reason that dog barks is if it sees a leopard. So we've come around here, and we're just trying to see if we can see a leopard. Perhaps Karula. She has been spending a lot of time in this area of late. We find her tracks. Very difficult to get a vehicle in there, but it might be her. And then Jamie has gone down the other side to have a look. She's not on drive, obviously, today, but she's out having a bit of a track. And so she's gone down the other side in the Mahindra to see if she can't spot something there. I can still hear the dog shouting. Now, again, like I say, not a particularly wilderness sound, but, well, I suppose you could consider it a wilderness sound if you consider people part of the ecology of the area. We've had dogs for many years. So we'll drive very gingerly through here. See if we can't see the spots stalking stealthily through the bush. Sounds like you've had an absolutely marvellous playing time with Scott. I think that's excellent. I'm sad you didn't re-find the Scops owl, though. That was an astonishing find the other day. Nice to have canaries. Oh, you did find the Scops owl. That is excellent news. I can't believe it was still in the same tree. Maybe they've got a nest there. I always like those little canaries. I find them most entertaining to watch. Not easy to film, of course. Oh, a very difficult inquiry from Virginia in Kentucky. It's a good question. Virginia, you want to know, does one species of bird understand the language of another species of bird? I'm going to just stop the car here and just hear, see if I can hear anything alarm calling in this bush, because this is where I think whatever is alarming those dogs is in here somewhere. So while I answer your question, Virginia, let's just keep an eye out on the bush there. Difficult if I'm not facing the bush, of course. There we go, it's better. Virginia, I don't know for certain. I was actually talking about this between some impala and I think it was Nyala the other day, wondering if they could understand each other. It was a zebra and a wildebeest. I think that there are elements that they can understand for sure. And I think you'll find with birds that the mimicry that there is with birds, you know how some birds can make the calls of other birds, has something to do with them communicating with each other in terms of saying, this is my territory is full here, go away, or you know, territory is full here, don't come and try and find food because I've eaten it all, that sort of thing. I think various animals also react to each other in the way that they can respond to each other's alarm calls. So definitely, I'm sure, when a battus starts doing its alarm call or a rattling cisticula starts doing its alarm call, I'm pretty sure that all the other birds in the area know precisely what that means. I think some of the mammals know precisely what that means. So yes, I think there is a lot of intra or inter-specific communication that goes on. I think it's there, even between things as different as birds and mammals, there's definitely some understanding. And I also think that there's quite a lot that happens on an energetic level that might be termed a sort of crassly, if you like, a ESP or extrasensory perception. I think they do communicate on an energetic level. I think they communicate on many levels that we as human beings with our totally visual and audio communication are unable to understand it as yet. Those grey lories are a little bit upset. But the dogs seem to have stopped. A little loop through here, and then we'll go back out and around this block. Now, what's interesting is that Graham was looking at a computer map the other day of sightings that Karula's had over the years, and her territory seems to be shrinking. And we think that she's spending more and more time in this little piece of bush here. That certainly would be borne out by the number of cats we see going in here, the number of animals that we have alarmed for in around here. To get a vehicle in there, you need a bulldozer. Driving around here, and we do sometimes, of course, a lot of you will hear when you are watching the Juma Dam cam, you will hear the territorial calls of leopard or lion. And Mike in Florida, you want to know, do animals go to specific areas in their territories where they think they might be heard better? Yes, I think they do. Maybe not specific areas in their territories, but certainly they will use up here again. They will use things like drainage lines and specific times of day to make their calls go further. Lions will call in the dawn, just when the kind of moisture's lifting off the ground, and they call. They'll call along the ground, so they'll often put their heads to the ground so that the sound does travel a bit further. They'll call in drainage lines because it then echoes out. Leopard definitely do that. They'll get into a drainage line and it'll echo up through the trees. So yeah, I'm not sure specific areas in the territory necessarily, but certainly specific habitat types within the territory would definitely make them call. So I think we might be in here. Can't hear anything further. Let's go around that way. talk to Aubrey quickly on the radio. Aubrey's confirmed that Ben is on Tortle. Just trying to find out what Aubrey said. He was at a hyena den, I think. Is that on Tortle? So there is a hyena den, but it is on Torchwood. It's not the same clan. That'll be a different clan of hyenas. And I think that our little clan of hyenas, which we've so enjoyed over the years, well, in my case over the months, but you've all enjoyed over the years, has a very clear territorial boundary just to the west of our eastern boundary. So we'll just do a gentle drive through here. Here comes the inimitable Jamie. She'll give us a little update. There's not a lot of space to get round here. I'll go in here. We'll allow Jamie to go past. Hello, Jamie. Let's shake hands like the men do, you know.
Okay,
here we go. Very strong, manly
yes.
thing to do. Thankfully, you're not manly. Here's Jamie, everyone.
Aye.
She's out tracking. And nothing, hey?
Nothing. And Cara's sitting fine. She's perfectly relaxed. It's just sort of bouncing around. And I investigated earlier when they
started. Those are the dogs, by the way.
Yeah. when they first started barking, I poked my head out and there was nothing. And he was running from gate to back of house to gate to back of house.
Maybe he's hungry. Okay. All right. Good luck.
Yes,
as you were. Keep us posted.
Will do. Anywhere in particular?
I'm going to go to Treehouse Dam now.
Okay.
It's roughly the only part of Juma I haven't checked today. Okay.
Okay.
Here he is now.
All right. What side of the dash?
Yes, they're on Torture. No, not Torture. Chipper, chipper. Yeah.
All right.
That's the dogs Jamie was asking about. Oh, well, no, let me, before I totally confuse you. So she talked about the dogs, and then she asked, what no sign of the madash, which is a kind of slang term for the wild dogs, and they are on Chitwa at the moment, which is well to the south of us, so we're not going to see them today, unfortunately. Well, maybe this afternoon, they're not deigned. Grace us with their presence this afternoon. So let's head down to Treehouse Dam. We'll head in that direction via quarantine clearings and see what there is down there. There's a little bit of mud there, and we saw yesterday a red-breasted swallow. I'm not sure which swallow Scott showed you today, but the red-breasted swallows are definitely in the process of making their mud nests. Quite astonishing constructions. They'll put them on overhangs of rocks, or if you've got a ceiling or an eaves, they'll often build there. And I'm sure they do that in the States and in Europe as well. And they build these amazing nests of mud with safety tunnels and all sorts of things that make it hopefully safe for their little chicks later on in the season. Still, I've seen one yellow weaver this season. None of them are building, none of them are weaving their nests. Maybe, and I think there are some traditional beliefs around this, maybe the weavers know something about the rain that we don't. Here are some beautiful nyala. What a lovely little occurrence. Young male. Very young male. Gosh, we've had two difficult questions. Thank you, Fran, from Virginia and Kentucky, about birds and whether they can understand each other. And our virtual tourist in Texas, you've hit me with one that I'm not sure I can answer for you. You want to know why it is that Nyala males have got such different colorations from the females. They look like they're wearing funny socks. They certainly do. And for those of you who perhaps don't know, Tebs is a male coming across the road if you want them. That's a female there. Well, that's my head in the bottom of the frame. That's a female, and the males are gray. They're the most sexually dimorphic mammals that I know of. And they're grey. And as virtual tourist point asks, why would there be different colours like that? I don't know. Virtual tourist, I actually think the males are a better colour than the females. As I've asked many of you, and we well, together I feel we failed to come up with a satisfactory answer as to why animals should be this rich chestnut red colour, which is so easy for our eyes to see in this bush. That grey colour of the male Nyala is much more difficult to see in the bush. As for the socks, I don't know. So, I don't... Virtual tourist, this my best answer is going to be a peacock's tail answer. Now, the peacock's tail, as many of you know, is a totally useless and superfluous appendage. It does not, it in fact places the peacock at risk. It places the peacock at risk. And it's got longer and longer over evolutionary time because females select peacocks for their long tails. So the longer the tail is, the more, the greater the selective pressure will be to have a longer tail. And that's why the tails have got so much longer over evolutionary time. And the question as to why that is the case is begged. And we think it might have something to do with the fact that because a long tail is a predicator of health, and it's a predictor of health because it's such a hindrance to survival that if you have a long tail, it proves that you're able to live and that you're able to survive the conditions and survive in adverse conditions, even though you're hindered by this tail, so your genes are so good that you're able to survive. And I wonder if there isn't some mechanism like that that has moved inside the Nyala population that has resulted in them having this kind of strange coloration and strange, very shaggy coats. Maybe the shagginess of the coat is some kind of peacock's tail. I don't know. Very interesting question. Virtual tourist in Texas, I shall keep thinking about it. And anybody else who has any ideas, please, I'd love to hear them. I normally find that somebody who's watching us has a very brilliant idea and a light bulb moment ensues. Diane, thank you very much for your compliment. You say we've given you a nice birding safari. I'm very glad you've enjoyed it. I feel that's more the birthday boy than me, but thank you very much, Diane. And Anna-Marie, you want to know, along the lines of a birding safari, what kind of do we get quillias here? For those of you who don't know, a quillia is a finch-like bird or sparrow-like bird that occur in great volumes, and specifically in Zimbabwe, you will get flocks of millions of quillia birds, and they're the bane of farmers' lives. They eat crops like waves of locusts, and I'll find you a picture of one here. And Anna-Marie, we absolutely do get them here, not in anything like the numbers that they would in Zimbabwe, but we do get them for sure. There's the red-billed quillia there. That's him. And we get there, you kind of a vaguely pretty poor illustration of this flocks that they make. But that is the red-billed quillia. And I've seen a few this season. They're nomadic rather than what we'd call migratory. So they don't go to specific places, but they do occur in an area and then disappear completely. So then they're quite nomadic. And what they eat is grass seeds. So when the summer comes, when the summer gets a bit later, say January and February, and the grass seeds are up on the culms, then you'll find they'll come through. Not in those enormous numbers, but we do get some pretty good sized flocks here. Wonderful to see them flying, not so great if you happen to be a farmer. And they, I mean, I was talking earlier on about how animals we think, or I think, communicate on levels that we don't really understand. And if you watch Quelea birds flying in a flock of a million, and much the same as those flocks of starlings you get in Europe and I think in North America, or a bait ball of fish, they don't crash into each other, but the flock almost moves like one organism, making these incredible shapes and turns in the air. We have no idea how on earth they do that. And there will be various crackpots who will tell you, well, I mean, my theory is probably quite crackpot too, but, you know, they'll tell you that they've got sensors on their wings maybe, or that they, you know, they communicate very fast in between each other. But nobody can come up with how a million birds can turn in the same direction without any kind of vocal communication whatsoever. It is one of the great mysteries to me of the natural world. And I'm sure that they are communicating on a level we don't understand. Right, quarantine clearings. This is a pretty devoid of animals at the moment. And I think that that is because there's no grass on it. And there's no grass on it because it was the last grass. Just looking here, possible tracks. Lots of hyena tracks. Very cleverly, Anna-Marie and Diane, you'll be pleased to know, Scott has managed to find some bee eaters at Arethusa Dam, I'm assuming, and I will see you just now.
Welcome back, everybody. I hope you've been having fun with James. I have no doubt you have. I'm just trying to work out where a large flock of European bee eaters have flown off to. They were kind of dotted around in all these trees to our right, and then they simultaneously, a lot of them took off and flew high into the sky and far away. And it's the bird that Siberia Zumi was apparently hearing at the Arethusa waterhole. When we got there about 5 minutes ago, there were no bee eaters in sight, and we couldn't hear any either. And as soon as we found them here, they've sadly all flown off. And I cannot hear them anymore, which means just bad luck, I guess. Our timing was off, not a problem though, as they are going to be here for a long time, and it's going to take us quite some time to actually get you good views of them. They're tricky birds to get close to. They're usually not very easy to film. They like to stay far away from the vehicles or fly very high up in the sky. Beautiful colorations and markings though, so something to look forward to. But it's not going to be easy to get you the perfect bee-eater shots. Maybe they're heading back towards the Arethusa waterhole, Siberia Zumi, so keep listening for them. Their call kind of brings out... tiny little... usually from high up in the sky. Oh. This is one of my favorite areas of Arethusa to drive through. We're on the southern and now western boundary, so just about as far away as we could possibly be from Juma. Notice the roads are a little bit bumpy, like now. And Judith would like to know, is there someone who maintains these roads, that drags something along them to keep them smooth? And yes, there is. On some properties, the roads are maintained better than others. and it will all depend on the landowners. At one camp where I used to work, the roads were incredibly well looked after, which make for an easier safari experience, especially when you've got guests on the back. The front row is the most comfortable. So remember this when out on safari, because most people, and I'm not sure what it is, but they've got the idea that sitting at the back, so everybody kind of tries to back row, it's the way to be because it's the most bouncy of all the seats. Anyway, there is somebody that maintains these roads. Heavy rains that we didn't get last summer and that we're probably not going to get this summer either, but we'll usually wash the roads away, and that's why there are often actually these big mounds that we go over that are almost like a speed bump, and that's to prevent water from gaining momentum and eroding the roads at a high speed. I'll show you one. This is a little bump we're going over, and then there's a little kind of drainway that runs off over there. So it's kind of a natural, well not a natural, it's a man-made gutter for trying to prevent rains eroding the roads, but it's a constant job. Anyway, we're going to send you across to James, who is in a better signal area than me.
A lilac-breasted roller on the theme of the birding safari that Scott has begun and seemingly doing a very successful job at, bar the problems with Wendy. And what I'm hoping that lilac-breasted roller is going to do, which it therefore inevitably is not going to do, is fly up and give you the display which shows why it's called a lilac-breasted roller. But it does this amazing acrobatic display, and that's why they're called rollers. It's called lilac-breasted, of course, because it has a lilac breast. Beautiful, beautiful bird. And interestingly, again, now here's another interesting one for you. Why on earth does that bird have male and females of the same bright colors? So how on earth, we think we know why it is that, say, the sunbirds have got birds or males that are different colors from the females. We think those bright colors are definitely like a peacock's tail, that it helped them to attract females. But why would you be such a brightly colored bird, male and female, when you both look almost completely the same? So I don't think it's an attraction thing, but why be that color? I think it's fascinating. And I'm just going to sneak backwards here. There's a bird on the tree behind us there. Oops. I'm just going to roll slowly back on the marula tree there. Is hopping on the branches. Oh, come on, Jigger. These old cars, I tell you, the wheels barely turn anymore. There's a lovely bird hopping on the marula tree here. It looked like a crested barbet. And if you can get them in the light, they'll just spectacular. Lots of bird activity going on here. Can't see anymore. I think it was a crested barbet. Beautiful orange and black and yellow and white here. Very scruffy there. Right, let's go to Treehouse Dam and see what's going on there. Hopefully those red-breasted swallows will be back collecting mud. Maybe there'll be a pride of lions lying on the dam wall. You just never know. Great saviour of the intellect. Monica, thank you. You say that the San Diego Zoo and Safari Park says that prey species are that red colour because their predators don't see it. They see it as green. Now, this dovetails with something that Brian said to me the other day. And, well, I mean, we know that animal, predators don't see in color, but they don't see in black and white. So they see a variation of colors, and it's probably a question. Brian had said it to me the other day. I think it's variations of blue and yellow, if I'm not mistaken. Anyway, so that green and red color will look the same, possibly, to the predators, as so that reddish color in the bush like this will look almost invisible. There we go. Thank you, Monica. I think you've solved the mystery to me, and it makes perfect sense. And what you can do, what we're going to try and do, and we'll try and manipulate a bit of footage, say an impala or a nyala with a green background. And we'll pull different colors out of it and see if we can make it disappear in the background. So I think that'll probably be a good idea for us to do with some footage when we've got some footage of a impala on a green background. Thank you, Monica. You've solved the mystery for me. Hooray. Also, of course, as it gets a little bit wetter, we've had the millipedes out, the myriapoda, or the shongololos, as they call in South Africa, and they're astonishing creatures, very ancient class, actually, of invertebrates, so animals without backbones. And Julia, you want to know what they eat. They eat bits and pieces of vegetation, fungus. I think some of them may be a little bit predatory, but I think they're not. I think, as far as I know, they're almost entirely vegetarian, but they'll eat fungus and they'll eat some pieces of the different kinds of vegetation. I think they have to be fairly unfussy because they can't move very far, of course, or very fast. There is absolutely nothing going on here. Go around onto the dam wall. And all the way from the freezing cold reaches of Alaska. Heather, I'm sure it's getting pretty chilly there. I've never been to Alaska. And as far as I'm aware, Alaska has the largest national park in the world, if I'm not mistaken. Heather, you want to know how many colors there are on a lilac-breasted roller? As far as I remember, there have been 7 colors counted on the body of a lilac-breasted roller. Now, the red-breasted swallow is here. That's him there, Tibbs. And let's just see if he doesn't come down. Oh, there's a yellow weaver! Second one of the season. Disappeared into this tree here. Okay, I'm going to leave the swallow for now because it's flying around and it will make you nauseous if you try and follow the camera. Now, in this tree, Tibbs, up in front of us here, there is a yellow weaver bird, and I want to see if we can't get him on camera. There, I can hear him calling. Stop, I'll let you listen to him. There, that is. There we go. Still no fresh nest building activity. I'll sneak a little bit forward. Let's try and get a look. They're very beautiful birds. Oh, you got him. You got him, Tibbs. Well done. Going to sneak a bit forward. See if we can't give up. Now, gone silent, of course, because he knows we're having a look. Let's go down here. Where are you, nasty little fellow? Oh, there he is. You got him, Tibbs. He's kind of halfway up the main trunk, hopping around in there. There you got him, well done. Right, everybody, that is the southern, no, it's not the southern mouse, I think that's a village weaver, and with a black face, and in winter, totally drab brown bird, and that one is now coming to full breeding plumage. Every year they change into that beautiful yellow color, and they make the nests that are so iconic. And I'm not going to get Tibbs to show you just now. Once we've stopped looking at the bird, I'll show you the old nests. But I think what he's trying to do now is attract some females. And I've seen them in this tree before. But I think they haven't started building because we haven't had much rain. And I remember, I forget which, hang on one second, I'll get back to you now. Jamie's just hailing me on the radio. Go, Jamie. Go ahead. No, negative. Copy that, thanks. Jamie is not too far from Gowrie Dam following a drag mark that she threw, so we'll go in that direction and help her once we've discussed this magnificent weaver. We had a viewer once who said that the weavers do predict, or that she'd heard that the weavers do predict whether there's going to be a wet year or not, and it is very dependent on... you can tell from where they build their nests. I forget what it was. If you look over there, you can see the nests are on the outside of the tree, and that either meant a year of high rain or low rain. I'm not sure which, and if they were closer in, then it would be the opposite. So you can see there, those old nests, they haven't been... Well, they won't be reconstituted, but there's absolutely no new building going on here, which I think is quite telling. Right, that is the village weaver, very magnificent weaver. The sun is out, it's starting to heat up a bit. So let's go and have a quick look where Jamie is. We'll just go and give her a hand there. And on we go. No rush. And I'm so pleased, Rebecca, in Santa Barbara, that you are enjoying our little birding safari. It is great fun, I must say. I really love it. And it is, they're all around us, these birds, and we do sometimes tend to get a little bit obsessed, I feel, with the big canaries, as they say. That is the call of the orange-breasted bushwhite. Now, the birders are out, ornithologists are out in force today. Deb in Kentucky, you seem to be a bit of a fan of the sparrow. We get three sparrows here. I think I may have just found you one. Tebs, before you start swinging that camera around, let me make sure that I'm not talking nonsense. Deb, you want a, it's not a sparrow, and that's disappeared. You want a grey-headed sparrow, which is pretty common. You want a yellow-throated sparrow, which isn't called a sparrow anymore. And for the life of me, I can't remember its name, but I'll find out for you now. And, or a house sparrow. House sparrow I haven't seen here, you know, which is probably a good thing. Passer domesticus. They are, of course, imported from the United Kingdom. They don't really belong here. suppose you might say the same of me, or my ancestors. But we don't see too many house sparrows are out here in the cities, absolutely. But the grey-headed sparrow is common, and the yellow-throated sparrow is not common. I have seen one here. I'll find you a picture of, or the name of him now. They're not common. Let's have a look on my bird app. Well, no one shouldn't operate a telephone while driving, but I think in the bush it's probably okay. Unlikely to come across any form of policing. Typing, of course, is the difficulty. Thrashing around on this car. Right, the yellow-throated sparrow. It's called a Petronia. A yellow-throated Petronia now. And I'm not even going to show you a picture. It's not a particularly impressive-looking bird until you really get up close and personal with it. Yellow-throated Petronia. Why it is now called a Petronia and no longer a sparrow? Well, that's beyond my ornithological knowledge. Sunbirds are out calling. There's a white-bellied sunbird I've just spotted. Tebs, just right in the top of this tree here. Can you see it there? You see that little white thing in the tree there? In that tree. If you go to the very top of that tree, keep going. That's it. You got him. Just to the right of that. There you go. That is a white-bellied sunbird. So that's another one for the list today. But, I mean, unless you've got a Hubble Space Telescope-sized lens on the end of your camera, seeing them, you've got to get pretty close. And also here, over there, so that is a black cuckoo calling, saying, "I'm so sad." What? There it is. Can you see there's some spider webs on there? Oh, I can see it here. I've got it now. Sorry, everybody, there's some spider webs.
Still there.
Still there. Gone?
Yeah,
gone. Okay, so what that is it's ballooning young spiders, spiderlings. I love the term spiderling. I think it makes it somehow could be arachnophobe. I'm sure that the word spiderling is far less terrifying than the word spider. And what they do, there's lots of silk all over the place. You find yourself driving along and then you do that and come away with a handful of silk. And what that is the spiderlings ballooning off, and they sit on the end of the trees and they send out a little strand of silk with their spinnerets, and eventually that strand gets long enough for them to lift off, and they fly off, ballooning away, and eventually they'll find a place to start a web of their own, or dig a hole of their own, or do whatever strategy it is that they use to eat. So we were looking at that yellow weaver, which excited me greatly. And Jenny, you want to know the males arrive before the females to get the nest ready? They do. The males spend a lot of time getting the nest ready because that's how they attract the females. A little bit like with human beings, the female weaver wants to know that her babies are going to be secure. And so she does a thorough inspection of her potential home and the home of her clutch of chicks. And then she makes a decision on whether she will acquiesce to mating with the male and having his offspring. So that is exactly how it goes. So I suspect that male, he's quite, well, I mean, he's not early for the season, but he's early on the tree, and he will now start to pull with any luck. Thank you, Mary, for your little anecdote that is really very valuable out here. Mary, you say that your father was colorblind and he couldn't see the difference between red and green, and he'd go into the garden and pick green tomatoes instead of red ones, which must have frustrated your mother, no doubt. Thank you for that. There it is. So that red, rich, russet color that we find on Impala and Nyala, and indeed one of our directors is explained now. So it's obviously invisible to the predators that don't see in color. Difficult one. Sharon, you've said I have a sharp sense of humour. Thank you very much. Some people find it a little too sharp, but I'm glad you don't. And you say, what is the funniest thing that I've ever seen an animal do? I don't know what sticks out in my mind. My father used to own a totally ridiculous animal called Trumpshaw. And Trumpshaw was a Staffordshire Bull Terrier, and quite possibly the dumbest animal to ever have graced the earth. And he was a walking comedy show. I mean, he did the most astonishingly amusing things, from lying on his back in the sun, all four legs in the air, with his mouth open and tongue lolling out. He was always very amusing to watch. Then he'd come and sit. My father was having his tea in the afternoon, and it was near walk time. Trubshaw would come and put his, just stare at my father like this, and then if my dad didn't get up with sufficient vigor, he'd take my father's hand and start to drag him, and then he'd start to bite. So that was quite funny. Out here, I think, the lions, because they are supposed to be these great noble creatures, I always find it quite amusing when they behave in totally slothful fashion. They, much like Trubshaw used to do, when they lie down like that and open their, they put everything on display. I find it tremendously amusing because we think of them as being such noble creatures. And then in terms of just general amusement, watching something like a squirrel or a dwarf mongoose and watching their little antics and activities, it's always quite funny too. Lots of funny things that go on out here. I'll try and think of something. I mean, of course, the funniest creature out here in the bush is, at Wild Earth, of course, is the staff. The staff members are generally the most amusing things that we spend time with. Everybody has their own perks. I'm certainly taking a game drive with VM or Andrew is likely to result in a very sore stomach afterwards. They are just very funny people. So, yeah, not often, not intentional. So, yeah. I will keep thinking about that because I do seem to laugh quite a lot at animals. Unanswerable inquiry about the spoonbill. Judy, you were watching with us the spoonbill in the Biffleswick Dam, and you want to know, does it have an adaptation that stops it getting dizzy? Judy, I don't know of one, and I mean, for those of you who didn't see it, they'd feed by moving their head from side to side like that continuously. I imagine that the brain is probably fairly well protected, but I think a little bit like an ice skater or a dancer, who is used to spinning around, you know, your brain gets used to it, so you don't get dizzy. I mean, those ice skaters who spin and spin and spin and then don't fall over have always astounded me. I can't turn around three times without wanting to fall over. And I suspect that all the spoonbill is used to moving its head from side to side like that. And I think that's why it doesn't get dizzy. That would be my guess. Question from Rick and Susie in Washington State. And why, Rick and Susie, you are not in Hawaii anymore unless you're a different Rick and Susie, which I find very unlikely. Please let us know why you're not in Hawaii anymore. And I am still looking for your lilac-breasted roller feather. Do not worry about that. You want to know if the spoonbill, African spoonbill, is this related to the roseate spoonbill? Just have a quick look at these young male Nyala, lots of them there. We're now into the area where Jamie was, where she found that drag mark. Rick and Susie, I imagine they are probably in the same family, maybe the same genus, but they're definitely not the same species, obviously. I think they are certainly related. Come out into the sun, these Nyala, and they're not grazing. They are brown on sort of very short herbaceous plants that are not grasses. So forbs, flowering plants. And I suspect they're probably quite aromatic, and I suspect also that they wouldn't be able to eat them all the time, because there will definitely be some kind of chemical protection in those plants that means that they're not eaten totally flat. We had an interesting question yesterday about what if there are any poisonous plants out here that animals are affected by. And I think one of the most interesting things about that question was that the animals out here definitely can cope with things that would poison us. So I know kudu can eat euphorbia. We don't get too much euphorbia here, but black rhino and porcupines will very happily eat tamburti, which is deadly for human beings. And I think that you find that those plants that they're eating are very aromatic, and possibly it's as is the case everywhere out here, there's an evolutionary arms race going on where there'll be a certain level of chemical protection in the plants that is slightly toxic, but the Nyala will have coped to deal with that for now. Okay, let's drive along the dam wall here. No yellow weavers here yet. Many old nests. We're talking about weavers, and Rick Swayze, you want to know how many nests a male village weaver will make during the course of a season. Rick, ideally just one, but they will make more than that. Because what the female does, if she rejects the nest, she'll then tear it to pieces and he'll start again. So if he does it right, I suspect he only makes one nest. If he does it wrong, I suspect he keeps building until he gets it right. They take a long time to build, so they don't want to be building too many. Now, apparently, Jamie said she had a drag mark going into this block here, and she had a hyena that was helping her follow it. I wonder if that's not the hyena we had at Biffles of Dam. It's coming directly in this direction. Oh, there's a beautiful virtual starling. Let's have a look at him while we wait and see. You can hear one of my favorite summer birds, the red-chested cuckoo, going obviously it's stopped now. There is the, so that's the virtual starling, and that's the starling without the yellow eye. There he goes. The other starlings have got, well, the other glossy starlings have got yellow eyes. Two glossy starlings that we get, the greater blue-eared glossy starling and the Cape glossy starling. And unless you see them in really good light, the only way to differentiate them is from the call, which I'm not very good at making. Let's go around the corner here. Related to the birds, Teresa, you want to know if I lived in Toronto. I'm assuming you are in Toronto. Teresa, no, I've never lived in Toronto. I do have cousins who live in Toronto, though. I haven't seen them for many, many years. But I do have some cousins who live there. I have no question in my mind that Toronto is well too cold for someone like me. I get miserable if the temperature ever drops below 10 degrees here. Oh, it's a really beautiful morning. The clouds are big, white and puffy, and they're diffusing the light really nicely. And I'm told that it is 19 degrees Celsius and 65 Fahrenheit. That sounds about right. And now this is a chilly wind which probably drops the temperature slightly, but it's about right. Line down here to have a look, and she thinks it's probably a hyena. I think that given the number of hyena we've seen knocking about today, that's quite possible. I'm going to turn around here because our signal will disappear if we carry on up this road, and it's not worth trying unless there's a truly magnificent sighting up there, which there isn't at the moment. Just head off a little bit into the center of the reserve to the thickish bush. Oh, I wanted to tell you, I was hoping to see Mbula. My hopes have been dashed again. He's on Torchwood. He is okay. He's fine. He's having a sleep under a bush, apparently, very soundly. Unfortunately, we can't go and see him because he is there. Ngana's tracks we have not seen for a while since his mating. I think he's gone into hiding. Karula, I think, is around here somewhere. No tracks yet, but I'm sure she's come back here and she'll wait out to see whether she's fallen pregnant or not. Now, when I say wait out to see, I don't mean in a conscious way. Her physiology will tell her. And if she isn't pregnant, she'll come into estrus pretty soon again, I think. As the sun comes out, so do the flies. See, young Tebs, who's just joined us, has not learnt the joys of the buff yet. And like many of the cameramen wear these buffs over their faces to keep the flies off them. So Tebs is going to be inundated just now. Let's stop and listen here. And we're listening to the call of the orange-breasted bushrike. It's just beautiful. Janine, you want to know if Tibbs replaced anyone? No, Tibbs didn't replace anyone. We've just needed to expand the team, especially with Big Cat Week coming up, which was very exciting. So Tibbs is on board to help us out to the end of the year, I think. Tibbs? Yep. To the end of the year. And who knows after that? Beautiful sounds of what is now turning into the mid-morning. Ooh-wee. Tibbs, I'm going to really challenge you now. I don't know if you can see. I'm going to sneak forward very slightly for you. There's a Franklin snoozing in a tree there. It shouldn't be doing because it's a ground-dwelling bird. Can you see it there? And if I didn't know that they nested on the ground, I'd say it was on a nest. Can you see it in there? I'll just keep zooming in there. There you got him. Look at that. There's a crested Franklin. And also, sorry, I was talking nonsense earlier. We've got a white-browed scrub robin calling and an orange-breasted bushwright. Right, that's enough nonsense from me before I make another mistake. Let's send you back to Scott, freshly aged 30, and some bee eaters.
Now, it's not very close, but on the... Oh, there it goes. Well done, VM. It's the European bee eaters we've been looking for all morning. And there's a few of them fluttering around here. Let's creep forward a little bit and see if it doesn't open up a few more view options. There's more than one here, but they're incredibly quick birds. Don't stay seated for too long, at least not close to the vehicles. Their cousins, the carmine bee eaters. Oh, well done, VM. It landed on this dead tree. Let me just jiggle the vehicle ever so slightly. See if it doesn't pop into a gap. Is it there? Oh yeah, I think right on top one may have landed as well. So you can see. Can you get, yeah, there we go. There's two of them, not very close, but these are the European bee eaters we've been looking for. Now, that's them calling. I was just about to say they haven't been very vocal, but that trip, 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 trip was them. And they're typically more vocal when they're flying, and they often fly in large flocks.
I think you're back with us, everyone. Ooh, watch out. Large tree. I think you lost signal with Wendy, so you're with us. Welcome back again, of course. You know, we have found, continued to find nothing, but we are going to hopefully find a few more birds. I've given up on the mammals. They clearly decided that Juma is not a place they wish to be today. Although we've seen some quite nice general game, the old Nyala, the old Impala. What else we can find along this road in the middle of the reserve. I think we're going to do this, we'll do Hyena Road again, which is this road here. No, we won't. We'll do Vulture's Nest Road. We haven't done that today. Maybe we'll be lucky with something there. Like I say, quite apart from the lack of animals, if you like, it has been a very beautiful morning and continues to be, so it's really just pleasant driving around and being out here. Hopefully a bird or two keep us going, sustained for the rest of the drive. We do love to hear from you when you tell us what kind of birds you'd like to see. So we're looking for sparrows, and anybody else who would like to see a specific kind of bird, obviously the Andean condor or something like that is going to be impossible for us to show you, but there's something vaguely on our bird list and we can keep a lookout for it. It's always nice to know what people are looking for. Susie, who lived in Hawaii. I'm not sure why anybody would ever leave Hawaii, but you say that the Pacific Northwest of Washington State has its own beauties, and your next stop will be sunny South Africa. Well, that's an excellent idea, of course. I believe it's quite rainy in Washington State. Certainly could use some of that here now. Probably hear as we drive down here the sound of the cicadas calling. So we'll head down towards the drainage line or dry riverbed. I need to get the word drainage line out of my vocabulary. There's a dry riverbed in front of us. We'll try and go down there and see. Birding wise, it's always very good down in them, and perhaps something else will be seeking shelter. There is around here a gymnogene or African harrier hawk nest there. Dash. I disturbed it. There's its nest. You see Tebs in the fork of this tree here. I'll sneak forward for you. You can just see the fork of this big tree up here. I'll just park next to it and then we can go. And there is the nest of the African harrier hawk, just up there. Just see a pile of sticks in the middle of the fork of the tree. It looks like an extremely scruffy place and not very comfortable for the young chick when it's born. Anyway, let's ease our way. There you go. You can see it just looks like somebody has dumped a load of kindling in the top of the tree. And I'm pretty sure that those gymnogene are, if they haven't yet, will be sitting on a clutch of eggs, because they're in that tree every time we come past. It's a beautiful torchwood tree or green thorn, and they're in here all the time at the moment. I don't know if you can hear those birds going just in front of us there. It's where that gymnogene's landed. They're all alarm calling at it. They're not very happy. You might also find something else for Tebs to eat, of course. I gave him some fairly unpleasant tasting food yesterday, some Bushman's grape. Maybe find something slightly tastier. There's the gymnogene. No, we're not going to be able to see it. Sorry, excuse me. Suddenly got a herd of frogs in my throat. Miss Lynn, while you're driving along, you want to know how far we drive during the course of a drive. It depends entirely, obviously, on the drive. If we find lions on quarantine clearings or a leopard just outside of camp, we might not drive even a mile. but now on a day like today when we are searching frantically for different things, I think we've been 3 hours, we probably do about 20 kilometers, about 12 or 13 miles. That's probably what we drive on a day like today. Yeah, so I'd say that's almost a maximum number of miles that we drive. So I've hardly stopped the car today at all because there hasn't been a sort of established sighting. So about 20 miles on it, or 13 miles on a day like today, I'd say the average is probably sits at around half of that. Six. Got Jamie on the radio. Go ahead. So Jamie's been following the drag mark of that hyena, probably, thank you, and she found it. She found where it started, hoping that there would be a leopard sitting in a tree looking upset that it had lost its meal, but unfortunately not. Now that came from a totally different direction from that hyena we saw this morning, who was carrying a nyala in her mouth. So I don't know where or what was going on where Jamie was around. We've almost done a full circle now. We're coming towards Twin Dams, where we began our little adventure this morning. The orange-breasted bushrike calling. So seldom actually see them. It's right in this bush. Oh wow! Wow. Just listen to that. So we have the first movement this morning, the explosive first movement of the symphony. We moved into the second movement, which was a bit quieter. Having a short burst of the third movement now. Starlings. You can hear the flutes going crazy. Just wish we could get a view of him because he's so beautiful. Drive around this bush, especially in the absence of large game. Tips, keep an eye out. There, they're there. Oh man, can you see them, Tips? Look, there's the orange-breasted bushrike. Now let's see if I can make him call again. He's not being fooled by me. Let's sneak back around. I'm glad you saw it though. Even though I can't see it now. Flown off. So you can definitely see there a male trying to woo a female with his beautiful song, and he looked like he was doing pretty well. Had a little companion. Maybe they're about to produce some smaller orange-breasted bushrikes. I mean, I asked for a quest on the bird list, and you've hit me with some pretty difficult ones. Nancy in Minnesota, a secretary bird or a quarry bustard. Yes, good ones. Both are findable here. Quarry bustard, probably rarer. Secretary bird, we definitely have seen a few times here. And then Jean in Los Angeles, I think you are. I'm not mistaken. You want to see an African ground hornbill. Now, that is a highly endangered. Black turkey. And as you guys head towards Thanksgiving, give a thought to the ground hornbill. Not that you'll be, I think they make appalling eating, but certainly they are an endangered species out here. A huge, big black turkey-like creature. Well, with a huge chisel-like bill on the end of his head. One that I don't think I'm going to be able to fulfill, and the other that I know I'm not. Barbara in Texas, you want to see hummingbirds. I'm afraid you're going to have to get in a plane and head, you'll probably find them at home, or head south into the Amazon for the best hummingbird viewing. I've seen hummingbirds in North Carolina before. I think you get them in the States, quite a few of them. We don't get hummingbirds here. Our evolutionary equivalent is like that sunbird that I showed you earlier, the white-bellied sunbird. We get four species of sunbird out here, and very colorful, long bill. They don't hover like the hummingbirds do, but they drink nectar. They've got those probing beaks for drinking nectar, just like the hummingbirds do. And then a request for a woodland kingfisher from Mary Ann, and woodland kingfishers should be back now. There was a report of one in Hood Strait the other day. We did have a vague report that one was seen the other day on the Juma Dam cam, but I'm suspicious of it because they haven't called yet. And I don't know why they'd be here and not call. So I don't know where the woodland kingfishers are. Maybe like the weavers, they know something that we don't. Hopefully, well, maybe. There is a, not a wooden kingfisher, sorry. This is a highly mobile European bee eater. I think Scott did show you a European bee eater. Ooh, there's one right here. Right here. Beautiful colors, amazing colors. Oh, you beastly bird. Sorry about that, everyone. He's flown off. And the bird you can hear going, southern boo-boo. A shrike of sorts. It's getting quite warm. Leaving those elephants this morning. Right. Let's have a look up back towards quarantine then. Maybe the buffalo will come out there and graze during the day. Often happens. had a... I decided not to do this on air, but Stefan Scott and I had a wonderful walk yesterday evening, and we found the nest of a thing called a Polyrhynchus ant. And it's a fairly nondescript ant, a black ant like that, with a large abdomen. It's not, doesn't bite. It makes quite an interesting nest. It looks like a sort of almost like a termite mound, a small termite mound under the ground. But the interesting thing about the Polyrhynchus ant is that its abdomen tastes like a lemon drop, and like literally a drop of sweet lemon juice. And I was prevailed upon to test this out, and so unfortunately for the hapless ant, I did in fact eat it. It was the most amazing taste to pick up a black ant and suck out its inside, which I wouldn't consider doing on a normal day. It was the most astonishing taste. So if we can find one of those, I might have to give it to Tibbs so that he can try that out. Very delicious. You wouldn't know? He's shaking his head with great vigor. Oh. Right, well, there's a mammal, fairly large one, biggest we can get. He's coming down the road in what it can only be described as the must swagger. You see that swagger that he's got? What I'm going to do is just move out of his way and let him come. I think you'll find... let's just get an idea of what he's doing. The elephants come down the road with that kind of swagger. You just want to step out of their way. I'm watching him carefully. He's still coming this way. I'm just going to move a little bit back to give him some space. No, he seems to have stopped. I think he's listening to us quite carefully. Here he comes. There we go. He's going to come out here, Tibbs. Beautiful elephant bull. Might not be doing the swagger. No, he doesn't look... Well, he's got a little bit of moisture on his inner leg. It's just... We'll stay with him. A bit of moisture on the inside of his back leg, indicating that he might have what that we call that green penis syndrome, where he drips urine almost continually when they're in that state of must, which is their time of mating. But that's the way he was walking down the road, that kind of swagger that they have when they're in must, which just says, don't get in my way, I'm feeling irritated. Let him walk quietly there. Lisa, you've noticed that it has been windy and there have been huge changes in the lion dynamics, and could that be putting pressure on the elephants? Lisa, no. No, I don't think either of those three things are related at all. I think the elephants have actually been remarkably calm. I think they're completely calm at the moment. This elephant is, you know, I can see he's a little irritated, but he's certainly not in the least bit aggressive. He just would appreciate probably not followed too closely. So we'll follow him down the road. There we go. So Lisa, I don't think that those three things are related. I don't think the wind has had anything to do with lion dynamics at all. We'd be able to smell if he was in musk now. very distinctive kind of sweet, spicy scent to them when they're in lust. There we go, the beautiful big bull rat. A bit of a mission. If he doesn't know of a section of plants that he wants to go and eat. Following him down the road a bit. Difficult for Tebs because every time we stop, we level the camera, he goes behind a bush and we have to move again. Right, here we go. Move again. We're going to have to just keep doing this trade. There he comes through the bush there. Alright, I think we're going to let him disappear into the bush quietly. I don't know that he's going to let us carry on with him. Just a few minutes left of show. And because we haven't seen a huge amount in the way of animals, a quicker shout out to Scott for his birthday and perhaps a small birthday song. Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday, Mr. Scott. You are old just like me. There we go, that will be Scott's birthday present for the day. Thank you all very much for your questions and contributions. On a quiet day like this, it's always so lovely to have your different questions and thoughtful, thought-provoking comments. So thank you very much for those. Thank you, Tev, for your efforts today. And we're going to hand you back to Scott now, after saying a quick thanks to Jerry and Nikki and Tara in the final control. And please wish Scott my very best. We'll see you this afternoon at 4 o'clock. Bye-bye and see you later.
What a beautiful day it is here, and thank you so much everyone, including James, for the kind birthday wishes. I really, really do appreciate it so much and look forward to enjoying the rest of the day out here. It should be a good afternoon. It's heating up quite a lot now, and there's a lot of clouds building in the south, so I'm not sure if it's going to be hot, if it's going to be raining, what's going to be going on, but either way, I'm sure we're going to have a good safari this afternoon and look forward to spending it with all of you. Again, thanks again, and I'm just going to let you now take a look at these beautiful clouds for the last few seconds of the show, and we'll see you all a bit later.